challenging ideas and questions to be raised that we'll pick up in a little bit. I'll introduce Donna Meyer, who's going to be our second presenter. Donna joined Mercy Investment Services as socially responsible consultant in 2012 and became director of shareholder advocacy in 2013. That was a quick promotion. She provides advocacy services for the socially responsible investment program with a focus on health issues, including domestic health, global health, and nutrition. Donna is also a really important colleague for many of us at ICCR and brings her many years of experience with CHRISTUS, with community health, and a number of other boards that she serves on that you can read in the bio. So Donna, please.
Good evening, everyone. We here are members of SRIC or friends of SRIC, and of course that means that we're members of ICCR. And so we work together to leverage our investment power, if you will, to catalyze social change. And today we are going to be talking about how we catalyze social change for healthcare. It's been so wonderful to hear our panel this afternoon, for those of you who were able to hear it, and to hear Dr. Farrar tonight talk about what is health, and because that is the context within which we need to think about our investments. We as investors alone cannot change the healthcare situation in this country. We are part of the collective whole. And so we need to understand what others are doing to address healthcare issues and how we can best fit in to make change happen. So our topic here today, of course, is health. And when we talk about investing, we talk about big, big dollars. In fact, in ESG investing today, I don't even know how many zeros this is. I'm sure Seamus is better at this than I am. But hundreds of trillions of dollars are committed to ESG investing. There are thousands of investment firms that say they invest for environmental, social, and governance causes. So it's a huge amount of money that is going into those causes. But when you ask most of those investment firms and people, they are mostly focused on environmental and governance issues. Jason and I, the afternoon panelists, were talking about it a little bit today, and I think part of the reason that there's such a focus on environmental and governance as opposed to health is because they have developed metrics. So those metrics are actually in the company's financial performances. And we in health perhaps need to do a better job with metrics. Because these big investment companies, if indeed they do invest in health, it's usually things like HR, fair employment practices, and it isn't the health of the community. Almost all of the resolutions that get filed on health are filed through the Interface Center, or ICCR. In fact, the resolutions that were filed this year were, the leaders were Catholics, the United Church of Christ, and the Muslim faith. There were some 50 co-filers. I went through them yesterday. They all were religious denominations. We just simply do not have a lot of the large investment firms. There were Baptists, there were Quakers, there were Jewish, there was a full range of Protestant faiths. And clearly, I think you all have heard Seamus address it this afternoon and again this evening, that we all, of all denominations, regardless of which denomination, think that health and healthcare is a human right, and that the health, and that we all should have affordable, accessible care to health And of course, most of us have kind of a preference for the poor and the most vulnerable among us. Though ICCR is very highly respected in the investment community, and when you work outside of ICCR, there's a lot of respect for the work we do, the fact is that we're talking about more like $400 billion, which still is a big number to me, but compared to the total investment community, it is a smaller size, if you will, that's working on healthcare. And so you might think of that first as a weakness, and of course it does require extra, extra determination to help make healthcare happen. There also is a certain opportunity there because we get to actually shape what we want to do in the arena of healthcare. How should we move forward and how should we do it? Most of that comes actually out of ICCR, where the drivers of healthcare in the investment arena. So that's one environmental factor that I think everyone needs to realize, is that we really, really need to engage more people in health in the investment community. The second factor, I think, I probably don't need to say so much about, because Dr. Farrar already said most of it for me, and that is, what is the difference between health and healthcare? Are we after keeping people well by introducing policies and programs that keep us all well, free from disease, or are we about curing people? Are we about giving people pills, about treating disease, and of all sorts? And I'd like to think we're about health, because health is so important to our economy. Encouraging people to live long, productive lives is very important for our nation. It's very important for individuals. And so I think as faith leaders, we feel like it's a really moral imperative. I thought this afternoon we didn't have time for all the discussion, but at ICCR, Seamus actually leads the section that deals with finance and all that money stuff, you know? And then we have a section that deals with climate, and we have a section that deals with water, and one that deals with food. These are just, we kind of divide up the work, right? And I work in health. Now, think about it for a moment, and think about what Dr. Farrar says. Do you think Seamus has more to do with the health of the nation than I do with pills? I think so. He's the one that makes mortgages happen. He's the one that sees that there's money. Do you see what I mean? I think I'm not at all sure that the financial sector doesn't drive health and the water sector and the food sector more than the healthcare sector with pills. Do you all? I see a lot of you shaking your heads, so you're not disagreeing. So as we plan for health and what we need to do as investors in health, we really need to think seriously when we're talking about the United States. Do we want to be able to treat diabetes, or do we want to address the obesity epidemic, right? Where do we want to put our efforts? If we're talking about Africa, for example, and Jason talked a lot about that. Do we want to be into, if we have limited dollars, treating people with malaria or helping people prevent malaria with mosquito nets and whatever all devices? Do you see what I mean? And so when we decide at ICCR, we're going to have a planning meeting in a couple months. We go through the SDGs, what the goals are, where the biggest gaps are. You identify the biggest gaps. Then we look at, where is there an investor handle? Where can we work with companies to make change happen? And so I don't want you to think when I talk about this that we're giving up on the traditional healthcare, because we still have resolutions on the ballot this year about healthcare drug expenses with the pharma companies, and I want you all to vote for those. We still are working with the international companies, and we've made lots of progress in seeing that we deliver health services in middle-income countries to low-income folks, as well as low-income countries, and we will continue to do that work. But I think we, as a group in health, are beginning to slide toward more focusing on health. How can we keep people healthy? Because we think it's a better investment of our time for the future. Now, we had a member who actually, when you think back about it, was a good example for us 15, 20 years ago. Some of you may remember Father Mike Crosby. Yes, we just lost him last year. Father Mike Crosby was a pioneer in tobacco and in getting people to, he was an advocate supporter for working with the tobacco companies, forcing them to stop advertising. And I remember when I first got involved with ICCR, which is almost 20 years ago, I hate to admit, the first win was that I got Eckerd's to quit advertising cigarettes in their Sunday paper ads. Do you remember when they used to have the cigarette ads right in the middle of the children's toys and the candy? Yes, every Sunday in the Sunday paper, yes. We got them to quit doing that, and we thought we were really doing well. And of course today, we would, drugstores better not sell cigarettes at all, right? We've made a lot of progress since then. But tobacco's yesterday, and one of the reasons for me even mentioning tobacco is because it is so much like nutrition today. There are so many parallels that you would not believe it. Dr. Farrar talked about personal responsibility, but think about it. For example, the Federal Trade Commission estimated that $10 billion was spent in 1 year on advertising unhealthy foods to America's children and youth. $10 billion. Now, if you're a parent, how loud a voice would you need to overcome $10 billion of advertising? And if you think this is old stuff, I believe this came out of the paper this last week or two.
Last week.
All of the pictures you see, Susan's shaking her head, and I can read the fine print. But I believe every picture I put up here today came out of the last couple weeks. It's not old news. This is new news, okay, you all. So, promoting health, Lucky Charms. They have new frosted flakes. They're called Lucky Charms and chocolate, both. And they spend huge dollars on TV and social media. So, Anna has been very active with General Mills. I work with Kellogg's and Nestle, and we're trying to get them to cut their advertising to children. It's the whole essence of what we talk with them about, and to label their products. I'm so glad you brought up labeling, to put labeling on the front of the products so people know what they're buying instead of having to wear their glasses and then they still can't see it. We also are working with Yum and Dine Equity to, and those kinds of, I guess you'd call them family restaurants, to get them to take sugary beverages off their automatic menu so that as a parent, if you order a menu, you don't automatically get a Coke, you get a water, or you get something healthy, and you have to specify in order to get the Coke. So we've done a lot of that, and we're proud of the work we've done. We've made progress. Oh, I've got to show you this slide first before I go on to the next one. This was done just recently as well. And you know, in the food pyramid, the top of the pyramid is, it's okay to have a little bit, and I think I've read some places that 5 or 10% of our diet can be fatty and sugary foods. And you see there on the other side that about 95% of the advertising dollars are for fatty and sugary foods. Do you ever see an ad for healthy vegetables? Have you ever seen a broccoli ad? Yes? You know, once in a while you see a chicken ad maybe, but nearly all the ads you see are for things we probably shouldn't be eating. Do you agree? And I don't think I'm exaggerating too much. But anyway, as we're working with these stores to try to get them to quit advertising, to not put it on the front aisles of the Kroger store so that you have to pass by the candy bars to check out and all those good things, what do you think these big companies are doing? They are sending their favorite foods to other nations, right? So we want to be sure we share our help with everyone around the world, right? And this was New York Times, I believe, last week, about how the obesity epidemic is growing. And I don't want to get into all the statistics, but obesity exists in every country of the world virtually today. They say about 30% of the population is either obese or overweight. And in the United States, the figure is about 25%, I believe, obese. Is that kind of the figures you hear too? And unfortunately, when we talk about advertising and cigarettes, we talked about billboards and advertising we could see every day. And these companies have gotten much wiser. That's not the right word. They've gotten much more devious, I think it's better. They have learned to advertise in ways we never thought of before. And it's not just social media. You know, we don't need to, I mean, it's easy to count the ads on TV. It's easy to count the ads in newspapers. We do not have good metrics for counting the ads that people forward to each other on social media. So we're not even able to count that. But look at this. This company, Hostess, is so proud of the tax rebates, so they're going to give a year's worth of free food to all their workers. Now, I hate to call that advertising, but would you call it promotion, maybe? And the other thing that happens frequently is kids, they have standards in a lot of schools for how much sugar and fat you can feed the kids, right? And so they will sell, they will give them little bags of Cheetos, but those Cheetos are specially formulated so that they meet the standards. But they package them exactly the same as a big Cheetos package so that they can convince the kids to tell their mothers to buy the real Cheetos at the store that are not specially formulated. I hate to accuse companies of all this, but when I was in Russia in 94, that was after we quit billboard advertising for cigarettes. They were still advertising on all their billboards all over the country. In fact, it was about the only billboard you could see was Camel cigarettes. And of course, I couldn't read any of the Russian language, but you could certainly read Camel cigarettes. So I think the same thing is happening today with foods. They're selling these foods to other countries, and they're finding ways to advertise that we're not really able to discern and track very well. So we've got to stay on top of it. There's another epidemic that's happening in our country that I want to talk about before we turn over the panel, and I bet you all can discuss. Can guess what it is, because I think they tried to put some of the epidemic on our table. And they're called, I missed it out. Do you guess what we're talking about? Did you all get your opioid fix? That's very clever, you all.
It's actually licorice.
But they promised that they're licorice, I think. So we have special. But seriously, we do have another epidemic that we're really addressing as investors this year, and that is the opioid epidemic. I'm sorry to say, this graph was through 2016, And if we had a graph through 2017, it's an even more startling jump in the number of deaths from opioids. In fact, if we could go back to 1999 through 2017, over a quarter of a million Americans died from opioids. Unfortunately, from a public health standpoint, deaths are the easiest thing to count, right? You know when someone's died. So unfortunately, everyone talks about deaths, and indeed, the deaths are terrible. They're bad for our country, they're traumatic. But I think we fail to recognize the other harm that opioids is doing to our country. They said yesterday at a Senate hearing that there are about 1 million people in the United States out of work on any single day because they are abusers and not able to work. So if you think of what that does to our systems, to our overall productivity in this country, and the estimate is that the financial toll overall of the opioid epidemic since 1999 is $1 trillion. Again, I don't know how many zeros that is, but it's too many. So the challenge with both obesity and opioids from the investor standpoint as compared to tobacco is, when we did the tobacco campaigns, you could really say, just say no, right? Because there is, as far as I know, no saving grace for smoking. There's nothing health-wise that tobacco helps with. But people do have to eat, and people with cancer and end of life do need painkillers. So on both of these, you can't just say no, but you've got to use good judgment in whether opioids are the best mode of treatment. And so I think the consensus is developing that for chronic pains, there are better ways to treat than opioids. So we, as investors, got pulled into the opioid epidemic, actually, rather than how we usually get into it, by the state health departments and the city health departments around the country, who actually called on the phone and said, listen, we're fighting this battle all over the country. We're doing everything we can, and investors aren't helping us. Can't you help us by dealing with the drug companies you own? So we formed a separate organization called the Investors for Opioid Accountability. And today, we did this last July. You wouldn't believe how fast it's grown.